Hello and welcome to BusyWorksBeats.com. Thank you for joining us today in the FL Studio 12 Strategy Guide Walkthrough for Beginners. Again, my goal in this series is to help you get through FL Studio, to learn the DAW so that you're not hung up on functions or how to do this or that. Because I want to give you these training videos for free right here on youtube.com/BusyWorksBeats, for example. We have a bunch of training videos, but the only way to take advantage of those is if you know the DAW. So that's why I'm creating this FL Studio series for you, so that you can learn your DAW and understand the stuff I'm talking about in the higher level videos. So let's get through. So it's okay that you're a beginner, first of all. Actually, the people who humble themselves to actually look for beginner content are the people who make brilliant music and brilliant ideas in the world. The person who thinks they're above beginner is the person who's too proud of themselves. So thank you for joining me and making that decision to even begin this beginner series, because you may just be overlooking some fundamentals, and that's all it is. You just might be overlooking some fundamentals. So great that you revisited the fundamentals today. So you're like, game, okay, why are we about to jump into a song? I don't know anything about the piano roll. I don't know anything about the mixer. I don't know anything about the channel rack. I don't know anything about the browser. Why are we about to jump into a song already? You know, it's kind of like talking to girls. I can tell you how to talk to a girl all day long, but if you don't do it, you're not going to know how to do it or how the real world works. So if I tell you, okay, comment on her shoes, comment on her earrings, comment on her hair, you're like, okay, I got the idea. But then you try to do it and you're like, hi, nice shoes. You know, it doesn't work. You have to kind of learn in practice. So even though you have the concept, you have to know the experience of it. So I'm going to start where we left off in this kind of jumbled, you know, what you need to know video. So we're going to start from scratch. So let's go to File. Let's go to New. And we're going to create a new project. So File, New. It's going to ask if you want to save any changes from the last project. If you had anything open, I'm just going to say yes, because I do. Now, this is not automatically saved. So the first thing you want to do when you open up a new project is go to File, Save, or Save As. I usually like to hit Save As just in case I opened up the wrong project. So let's go to Save As. So let's call this, instead of calling it Untitled, let's call this Beat Making 101. And let's hit Save. Now, in my FL Studio, I have different folders for different FL Studio projects, but we'll get into that in a more advanced FL Studio training. But here you can see under your computer files, it goes FL Studio, Data. Then under the Data folder, there's a folder called Projects. Under that folder, you can create more folders and you can organize your projects that way. Or you can just save all your projects in the Project folder. However you like to stay organized, that's your call. So I'm going to hit Save, and notice we're saving as an FLP. Which is a Fruity Loops project file. Okay, so now we're good. Now we have the project saved, and now we can start making changes to this project. So literally, we're gonna go through a song in this video. I'm gonna make it so you can follow along. I'm not gonna use too many advanced concepts or terminologies. Keep in mind, if you ever hear me use an advanced word, I will define it. So do not freak out if you hear me use a word that you're not used to. Okay, I will define it, because I know when I start to use higher level words. So the first place we're going to start is the metronome. This will help us measure. It's so important to measure. You know, I see beginner producers all the time. Their beats are off beat. They have things that just don't make sense rhythmically. And, you know, just like in anything, if you're lifting weights and you're trying to reach 180 pounds, you need to know how much you weigh. If you don't know how much you weigh, how do you know if you're ever going to reach 180 pounds? So you need a scale. A scale is there to measure your weight. So we need to use the metronome to measure where we are in time, because time is a relative thing. Let's click on the metronome and let's just hit the space bar. I'm going to be using the space bar to basically hit play. So whenever you see the play button going and I forget to kind of explain what I'm doing, I'm hitting space. And when I hit space again, it stops the song. So spacebar is one of your best friends as well. Okay, now you can actually change the metronome sound. This will actually come in handy, because I find that this sound is very hard on the ear sometimes. So if you want to change the metronome sound, just right click on your metronome icon. I like to change mine to a hi-hat. It's just a little more subtle. That's just me. Okay, you can change it to a cowbell, whatever you like. I mean, whatever sound pleases you. The beep is a little loud for me, so I usually right click and go to hi-hat. So that's minutia, but that's something that might help you right away. Okay, so I'm not going to go into minutia. I'm just going to get into things that actually matter. So we're just hitting spacebar, getting used to the metronome. So the metronome is counting. As I hit space, notice that the channel rack is actually moving. It's measuring in the sequence. 1, 2, 3, 4. So in short, I'm not going to get into music theory here, but every time the metronome hits, we call that one beat. So 1, 2, 3, 4. 1, 2, 3, 4. And in what's called 4-4 timing in music theory, which is the most common timing. I'm not going to get into music theory. If you want to learn more about music theory, go to busyworksbeats.com/music theory. We have more courses and free videos on these terminologies. But in short, 4-4 timing is the most common. So every time the metronome hits, that's one beat. 1, 2, 3, 4. Every time we count to four, that's considered one bar. Usually, okay? Now, I say that because if you are producing in halftime, for example, it can be a little bit different. But that's more advanced. So in general, when you hear the metronome, that's one beat. 1, 2, 3, 4. And for every four beats you hear, that's called a bar. So think of a beat like the heartbeat. 1, 2, 3, 4. It's the pulse of the song. 1, 2, 3, 4. And think of bars like gold bars. They're bigger. They're not small. You know, it's kind of like thinking of gold dust versus a gold bar. A gold bar is pretty big, whereas gold dust is very fine. So that's how I like to think about, you know, beats versus bars. Beats are like the heartbeat. 1, 2, 3, 4. And then the bar is the whole kind of picture. So here's how we count bars in general. 1, 2, 3, 4. 2, 2, 3, 4. 3, 2, 3, 4. 4, 2, 3, 4. And we just counted four bars. So the point is, we're using the metronome to measure beats and bars. And bars are going to be the most commonly used term in music production. Beats, however, are not as commonly talked about, unless you're talking about a rhythm style. We talk about bars more often. Okay, so bars are compilations of beats. So again, if you ever get confused, the metronome resembles the heartbeat. Heartbeat. Okay. So now let's look at the BPM, beats per minute. This is how we measure our heart rate as well. So let's left click our tempo. You can also right click to get more direct numbers. So if you don't feel like left clicking and dragging to the precise number, you can always right click and select the general BPM. So if you want to right click and you know it's divisible by 10, we can click on 80, for example, and hit space. Okay, you can right click and go to 120 instead of going from 80 to 120 and left clicking, and it takes forever to kind of slide it. Okay, so it can save you some time. Now to the right of these numbers, this is minutia. This is something that is not important. But to the right, you'll see these kind of fine-tuned numbers. I generally don't move these because I don't want my song to be hard to translate in other scenarios. So I usually like to keep my BPM as a whole number. I don't like to have, you know, 80.05 BPM. That's just a random thing. But if you're one of those people who like to, be very complex and very different, you can go about that. But that's minutia. Okay, something that's not that important. So let's right click and let's set our tempo to about 100 BPM. That's a very common dance BPM. Okay, so the rest of the stuff you really don't need to know right now. Okay, unless we use it. So this is what I'm saying. When we go through the song walkthrough, I'm only going to talk about the stuff that you're going to see a lot and explain it as we go. So that's the metronome. Now that we understand the metronome, let's get into actually writing a song. So let's start with sound. We need sounds to make a song. I'm not going to pull out a lot of samples, but I'm going to show you the process. So let's open up the browser. That will reveal, this button here will reveal your drums, your imported sounds, and I'll get into how to do that later. So under packs, this is automatically installed in your FL Studio, especially if you have the newly updated one. It comes with a drums called Drums Mode Audio. These are really cool samples for EDM specifically. So if we open up this folder, we can start loading up sounds. So the first sound I want is a kick. So let's go to our kicks under browser. And if you just left click, it will preview the kick. So I'm looking for a very short kick, not a long kick. So I'm just left clicking to and scrolling with my mouse to kind of preview the sounds. I like that one. I like this one here. So let's say you find a kick you want. Okay, how do you make this kick? How do you put this kick and overlap it with that kick? There are many ways to do the same exact thing in FL Studio. The first thing you could do, which I suggest you do because sometimes you can accidentally make mistakes. So here's a safeguard I like to use a lot. Right click and go to open in new channel. Trust me when I say this, because you'll notice sometimes in some of your projects, I'll show you the other way. So anyway, right click, open in new channel. That will open up a new sampler, which holds the new kick. Okay. Now the reason I didn't do it the regular way or the other way to left click and drag in the channel rack is because sometimes, let's say I was trying to replace my kick. So you can left click and drag samples. And it, let's say I was going to replace kick one, but I accidentally put it into the clap folder. Now I'm like, oh man, there's no way to undo that. If you hit Control Z, it will not restore your clap. So that's why I say I tend to stay away from dragging samples into the channel rack, even though you can do that. Okay, so when you feel comfortable doing that, fine, go about it. But when you mess up and you accidentally overlap a sample, there's no way to undo it, from my understanding. There might be a way, but it's minutia. Okay, so just keep that in mind. So that's why I like to right click and open a new channel. Now, this new channel is not sent to the mixer. Remember, I spoke about the mixer and what you need to know. So that means, so a very common practice, when you open things in new channel, just assign it to a blank mixer. And what that means is find a spot that's not taken by a number. So we have 1, 2, 3, 4. So let's count. The next number after 4 is 5. So let's send this to track 5. Again, if you don't see these numbers on the left side, you want to hit Alt plus M to hide or reveal these. And you can always click inside your sample and look for the track number if you don't see those things on the left side. Let's left click and select track 5. So now this kick is accounted for in our mixer. So now we can do stuff to it, and that's very important. Now, generally speaking, since I said I'm going to show you how I make a song from scratch, I'm going to show you how I make a song from scratch. So what I usually do, firstly, I don't use this template, but I'll get into that later. Let's right click, and I usually hit D to delete and Enter to delete the sounds I don't want. So I generally don't want the beginning sounds, and I like to start with just a blank sampler, not going anywhere. Then what I like to do is right click the sample, for example, and go into new channel. And now we don't have anything routed to our mixer. So now we can start back from track one. So let's left click and pull that back to track one. And then I like to right click and delete the sampler because there's nothing in the sampler. So that's how I usually start a project. I get rid of every template, sound in there, and then I just insert my own sounds. So let's pick out a clap or a snare. Let's go to claps first. So let's say you get confused in your browser. You're like, oh my gosh, how do I find which folder I was in? I don't even know where the clap folder went. You have like 1,000 samples in a row. You're like, how do I figure out anything? A quick button to kind of make things easier is the collapse button in your browser. This will close up any folders that you may have open. So this is a folder I use a lot. This is a button I click a lot, the collapse button. Let's go back into packs. And let's go to drums mode audio. And let's go to claps this time because now I want to clap. And now let's cycle through the claps. Now let me go back into the channel rack. Again, if you don't see your channel rack, just click this button twice. And I'm going to left click on this little button so I can select the kick. And I'm going to hit the comma button on my keyboard. Or you can hit any key on your MIDI controller if you have it set up. But I'm going to hit the comma button on my keyboard to play middle C. That's just so I can hear the sample. Because sometimes I forget what the sample sounded like. Just like right now, I forgot what the kick sounded like. And now I have to kind of preview it to hear what I want my clap to sound like. So I want it. So let's find a clap that sounds like. This kind of has it, but it needs to be pitched up. So let's right click, go to open in new channel. Notice how I'm using the same kind of, functions over and over and over again. Okay, now the next step, we're going to send it to the mixer to track 2. So now it's accounted for. And the next step, I'm going to left click on this little button here. I'm going to hit the comma button to preview the sound. And I'm going to cycle between the two. So this needs to be going. It needs to be. So I'm going to show you things along the way that are not minutia, but things that will help you. So now we need to pitch the clap. It needs to be. So now let's go to pitch range. When I'm pitching things, If it's tonal, I like to change my pitch range to one if I think it's just detuned by a little bit. But if I think it's a clap or something, I like to change my pitch range to about two, generally speaking. And now we're going to change the pitch knob. So let's left click and pull the pitch knob up because we need to pitch the clap up. It's too flat right now. And it's going, it needs to be. So let's pull the pitch of our clap up. See, we're not there yet to the pitch that I have in my mind. So we need to up the pitch range so that we can go higher. The pitch range is based in semitones. There are 12 semitones per octave. You'll learn what this means later. In short, these are increments on your keyboard. So every key on your keyboard is one semitone away from the next key on your keyboard. So that's an easier way to think about it. So, we go over this in our sound design series at busyworksbeats.com/sound design because you're going to need to know what sense means, what semitone means, what pitch is. And we go over that in our sound design series. It's free and it's a beginner style course. So go to busyworksbeats.com/sound design. So for the clap, we're still not there yet. So I need to pull my pitch up higher. So now we're closer. Okay. So now what I like to do is usually preview the pitch. So to do that, let's go back to our channel rack. And now we can left click in notes to draw out a small sequence. I'm just going to hit space bar to play it. And let me turn off the metronome by left clicking. So I like to just test the pitch in context. So I was just testing the pitch there. I wasn't trying to draw out a sequence. Now you can left click to add notes and right click to delete notes. But keep in mind, you have to be on that specific row. So if I right click down in the attack clap, I can't delete notes from the kick. I can only delete notes from the clap side. If I right click the kick, I can't delete anything on the clap row. So just keep that in mind. That's a small little thing that you just don't realize, but that's important. So now we need more sound. So let's go back to our, let's collapse the claps folder. We can just left click this button to collapse that folder. Let's look in the hi-hat folder. Now we need hi-hats. I like this hi-hat. So let's right click, open in new channel. Now again, I'm going to show you my way of going about things. And ways, the reason I do this is because I used to do it another way and that led to a lot of complications. So here's where a lot of producers get caught up. They start putting everything into one pattern. For example, they'll put their kicks, their hi-hats, their instruments, everything in the one pattern. I'm not saying that's wrong, but what it does is it makes it harder to arrange your song in the long run. So for example, if I have all my drums, all my piano melodies, all my chords, all my bass lines, all in pattern one, you know, it can get confusing when we're trying to build out the full puzzle because we only have one puzzle piece. So it's harder to actually build a puzzle with only one puzzle piece. So I like to separate things into different puzzle pieces so we can create a more complex puzzle. So usually I like to separate my hi-hats from my kick and clap. What we're going to do now is right click on the hi-hat sequence to get rid of it. I don't want my hi-hats together with my kick and clap. So here are some common things I do personally that helps. Drums that I put together are usually the kick and the snare or the kick and the clap. So those usually go in their own pattern. Another pattern will be hi-hats, for example. Another pattern will be percussion elements. Another pattern will be the melody. Another pattern will be, you know, chords. Another pattern will be bass line. So I separate things, and that's so important when it comes to songwriting. I cannot stress that enough. If you start building everything into one pattern, again, you're only going to have one puzzle piece. How are you going to build a complex puzzle with one puzzle piece? There's no creativity in that. There's no customization to it. So if you want to save tons of headaches, trust me when I say this, separate things on different patterns. Excuse me. So now what we're going to do is go to a new pattern. So firstly, again, we need to send this to the mixer. So let's left click and change the number for our hi-hat so that it's routed to track 3, the empty track. 1, 2, 3. Great. We have all the tracks, you know, occupied up to 3. So again, let's start building as if we were writing out a full song. So on pattern 1, let's create a kick pattern. Now, again, we have so many tutorials about rhythms and different genres. I'm not going to break it down that complex because this could take forever just explaining every little thing. Right now, you can, you know, follow along if you want. by just copying the notes. So in short, the clap is going to go on the two. Remember, if we turn on the metronome, one, one, two, three, four. So the clap goes on the two and the four. One, two, three, four. So that's why we use the metronome to measure music. Let's go to a new pattern. And now we want to create a hi-hat rhythm. But the question is, okay, how do we hear our drums so that we know what type of hi-hat rhythm we want? So here's where the playlist comes into play. Let's click on the playlist icon. And now that we have active patterns, we can go to our pattern icon. We need to right click, okay? And then we need to select the pattern that we want to add to the playlist. In this case, pattern one. Let's left click and select pattern one. Now, I like to use the paintbrush tool, not the pencil tool, for many different reasons. So click on the paintbrush tool and you just want to left click. Also, another common thing, I like to change my snap to grid to bar mode. This is extremely important that you do this. Put it on bar mode so it makes it a lot easier to align your music. Change your snap to grid to bar mode, unless you need to be very specific with smaller increments. And we get into all that advanced stuff in all our training right here at BusyWorksBeats.com. So let's just left click and drag this pattern one icon out for about 16 bars, just so we have a decent playground to work with. Now we can move into pattern two. And even if you don't have anything in pattern two, as long as you go to your channel rec and as long as you click on your paint icon, you can actually left click and paint in pattern two, even though there's no content in pattern two. And I say that because if you right click your pattern clips icon, there's no pattern to select from. There's nothing there. So this is a common practice I like to do as well. If I don't have MIDI information or any sequence information, I just like to go to the channel rack, select the pattern I want to add, go to the playlist screen, grab the paint tool and just left click and add it in. It automatically adds whatever pattern that you're on into the playlist. Okay, so now I can start hearing my hi-hats as I'm previewing my drums. So to switch between pattern mode, instead of playing just this drum pattern here, we can actually go to the playlist mode or song mode by left clicking this icon here. When it's orange, it means you're playing your pattern, the sequence. When it's not orange, you're playing your whole song as a whole. So the reason we do this now is so I can hear in context our hi-hat. So let's go to pattern two. And now I can start left clicking in hi-hats live. And I can erase notes if it doesn't sound right. Okay, so I can hear if stuff sounds off. Whereas before, if I did this in pattern mode, I wouldn't know anything about where the kick is or where the snare is. I would have to keep going back and forth between pattern one and two. And that's super tedious for no reason. So that's why I like to go into the playlist mode. So not only are you learning FL Studio, you're learning good habits that will ultimately help you write out songs a lot easier in the long term. And you will avoid so much confusion. Trust me, I've gone through so many bad workflow habits. And I found the best of the best way to work through it in FL Studio. So that's why I'm showing you these kind of insider tips as we go along. So this is more than just functionality. That's why I wanted to show you how to write out a song. You know, I could tell you how to comment on a girl's shoes all day long, but if you don't do it or get the tone right or get the expression right, it's going to sound weird. Hi, nice shoes. You know, that kind of thing. You got to be like, those are really nice shoes, you know, or whatever. So it's a big difference. So let's go to pattern two and let's start drawing out our pattern. Now we're going to keep it very basic because I don't want to send you into the complexities of FL Studio without the core understanding of what it does and how to use it. So let's go to pattern three now because I want to add new elements that aren't the kick and the clap and that isn't a hi-hat. So let's go to our library again. If you don't have your browser open, click the browser icon or the folder icon. And let's say you want to add more things like a shaker or percussion or some kind of cymbal. Let's say we want to add percussion. So let's go to the percussion folder and let's see what we can add. I'm just going to cycle through. Now notice I can hit the space bar and preview these sounds as the song's playing. And also I can hit the down arrow. Instead of left clicking, I can just hit the down arrow. I think this is a cool sound. So I'm going to right click, open a new channel. And again, we need to send this to the mixer so it's accounted for. Let's left click, pull that up to track four in the mixer. Again, now we want to hear pattern three in context. So what do? We go to the playlist. Make sure you have pattern three open, firstly, so you can left click and change your patterns here. Have pattern three open. Go to your playlist screen. If you don't see it, click the button there. Grab the paint tool and add in pattern three. It's going to be blank, but we need this in the playlist so that we can, when we add notes, it knows where it is in context. So now when I hit the space bar and go back to our channel rack screen, we can actually place the sound properly. So let's say we want to change the pitch of this percussion. Right now we don't want it to play the same pitch. So here's where we start getting into, you know, the piano roll. If we want to change the pitch of something over time, I suggest going to the piano roll. So this is a percussive element, but it's tonal. So I'm using the sequencer because it's a percussion element. I'm using the channel rack, these little dots, because it's a percussion element. It's not an instrument, but I want to give it pitch control. So we need to go to the piano roll. Let's right click and go to piano roll. This will open up our MIDI screen. I like to hit the maximize button. There's no reason to really have it restored in that smaller version unless you're trying to do something on the side. Now this screen looks very complex and I don't like it. So I'm going to show you a quick way to change it up. In the top right, if you left click and pull it down, you'll see the notes here. And also it looks like they've changed this. This is an update. They usually give you the note value for each note. I'm not sure why they changed that. So let's see if we can find the options to change that. Let's go to the piano roll options, go to view, and we need to see keyboard style. Let's change that up. Let's go to view. Honestly, I don't know why they changed it because it was fine before. Oh, okay, key labels, and let's go to all notes. We need those so we know where we are. And this helps you learn music theory as well. So I'm not sure why they reset it like that, because that just adds more confusion. Let's go to piano roll again, view, key labels, and go to all notes if you want to see every single note value. Also, I'm going to go to keyboard style and I'm going to change it to the style I like. So let's go to view, keyboard style. I just want to see which looks best. For me, I think it's probably the first option we had. So keyboard style, let's go to classic. Now what we need to do in the MIDI to see the notes that we're generating, you can, in the top right, you can see I'm left clicking and dragging and it will scale the keyboard. It's important because you'll see what happens in the piano roll. Anyway, when we start adding longer notes, it'll be more obvious. So here we have. So now I want the next two notes to be F and G. So what I'm going to do is hit control, left click to highlight this specific note. You can manually left click and move it up. The reason I hit control to select is so it doesn't sound. If I just left click and drag, it will sound each note. Maybe you like that, but sometimes you're not going to always want that. So I like to hit control, left click and drag to highlight. And we're going to get into the piano roll. Again, we're going to get into it more in more depth later. Right now, you just need to know what you need to know. And that, you know, I'm showing you the most common things that we go through in songwriting. So now I'm hitting the space bar to play. So now the percussion changes pitch over time. It's not just the same. You know, that gets boring if it's the same pitch all the time. So that's what we're going to do in the playlist. So notice it's very repetitive. So what I like to do, and I'm not going to get into every little thing about songwriting because it could take forever. What I like to do, every fourth bar generally, or every eighth bar, depending on which genre you're in, I like to change the stuff up so it doesn't sound repetitive. So let's hit control, let's left click where it says bar four. And I'm going to hit control, left click on the timeline, this little darker bar, the black bar here, to select only bar four. Let's hit the stop button twice so it resets back to this playhead, because if you have it over here somewhere, it will start over there. But what we want to do is lock it into this specific place. So I hit stop twice to do that. It will reset it to that selected area only. And you can hit space bar and it will loop. That's important because we need to create a change up. So to create a change up, we need to change these patterns. So in short, we don't want to change the original pattern, because if we do that, it will just change every other pattern as well. So it's not really changing anything. It's just making everything the same. To make a new pattern, a quick way to do it with the same MIDI information, for example, for our kicks and claps, if I right click here to solo, let's say you just want to add another kick or change up the clap only with the kicks and the claps pattern. You want to go to the top left where you see this little piano icon. Go to Make Unique. That will duplicate that pattern. In the FL demo, you can't make unique because it doesn't allow you to duplicate patterns. So that's restricted in the demo version. So we're going to do that for each of these patterns. Pattern 3, I want to make a new version of the hi-hat. So let's go to the top left and go to Make Unique. That will clone the original pattern, but it will make it a new pattern, pattern 4. So now we can make changes without affecting pattern 1, which cycles through the whole song. Again, let's select pattern 5 here, Make Unique. So now we need to change every fourth bar into pattern 6, for example. So how do you do that? You hit Control and Shift. You left click and you highlight every fourth bar accordingly on whichever thing you're trying to change. Go to your top left, go to select source pattern, and we're going to change it to pattern 6 because that's our change up, where we're going to add the change up. And we're going to do that for each thing that we want to change up. So let's hit Control Shift, left click and highlight every fourth pattern 3. And again, we're going to go to the top left, select source pattern, and we're going to change this to pattern 4 so that it's the new version of it. Same with the drums. Control Shift, highlight every ending fourth pattern, go to your top left, select source. We're going to change this to pattern 2 because pattern 2 is where I'm going to change up the drums. So now it goes 5-5-5-6, 5-5-5-6, 5-5-5-6. So there's a change up every fourth bar rather than it being the same thing all the way through. Now let's go back to pattern 2. You can do this easily by either changing your pattern icon and going to the channel rack, or you can just left click here and go to edit pattern. It will pull up the pattern. I just like to do this and X out of the piano roll, whatever you want to do, and hit the channel rack button. So let's change something about the drums. So I've added 2 more kicks. So that's the difference between pattern 2 and pattern 1. Pattern 2 has 2 more kicks added, okay, but it doesn't affect pattern 1. So let's change up our hi-hat rhythm. Let's go to pattern 4. Let's edit pattern. I like to X out. It usually pulls up the channel rack. So let's add a couple more hi-hats in here. Let me check something real quick. This is an aside from the video. I just want to see something. So I'm going to open up the piano roll. Okay, I was just checking the velocity. Okay. Let's go to pattern 6 because that is our turnaround. So let's right click. I want to change the pitch. I don't want it to go C, F, G anymore. I want it to go bum, bum, bum. So I'm going to left click on this icon and I can just right click the other notes. Okay, so now we can X out. So now that's different. So now I can hit Control, left click and unselect the loop area, hit stop twice and just hit space bar. So now listen, every fourth bar, and to zoom out and in, what I'm doing is using my mouse wheel on this little black bar here to zoom in and out. Monitors so you can hear what's going on. So every fourth bar we have that change up in the drums. So subconsciously in the Western style of music, we hear things in fours and we just expect things to change after the fourth thing because we're so used to 4/4 timing when it comes to music. So that's why we like to change up every fourth bar. So I'm not going to make the song too complex, but I want to show you every little thing, every good habit you want to build over time. Because this adds up. Trust me, you will save years of your time. dabbling. Now we need sound. We need something that either generates a melody or generates chords. So we need to hit the plus button and we need to decide which instrument. I'll get into all these instruments later as far as which one. Most of them can create the same exact sounds. Okay. So don't get all crazy about them. Let's just open up for chords. Let's open up FL keys. So we have a piano. Again, what's our habit? We need to send this to the mixer. So let's left click and send this to track 5. So let's open up our mixer. And things, you know, everything does not need to be the same level, the volume. So what we can do here is use our faders to turn stuff down. I'm not going to get into mixing too heavily yet. For example, the hi-hats do not need to be as loud as the kick. So let's turn those hi-hats down. You can also use this pan pot to turn it left or right. So I'm going to pan the hi-hats left and then pan this other percussion a little to the right so it has a balance. You can see it gets a little louder, so let's pull that down in volume. Now I also notice the kick is a little, the pitch is different. I want to pitch it down so it goes boom. So let's pull our pitch knob down. So it's a little more in tune. We have a whole tuning video. Type in tuning, Busy Works Beats. It'll pull up the video for you. It goes in more depth about tuning. So now let's add chords. Again, go to a new pattern. Here's the biggest mistake I see all the time. Producers will start adding the FL keys, for example, in their drum pattern. And then when it comes to songwriting, again, you're compiling puzzle pieces, which makes it harder to make a more complex puzzle. So let's go to pattern 7. We're going to right click, go to piano roll, and let's draw out some chords. I'm not going to make this complicated. But what we need to do, if we want to preview the sound as we're building it, we need to add pattern 7 into the playlist. Right now, pattern 7 is nowhere to be found in the playlist. So we go to channel rack, make sure you have pattern 7 open, and just grab your paint tool, left click it in. Now for longer patterns, like a chord progression, for example, it's going to be longer than one bar. So what I like to do is drag it out for a minimum of about 4 bars, generally speaking, so that I can hear it up to 4 bars. Let's go to the channel rack. Let's right click, go back to the piano roll. And now I can add chords in. Now we go over chords and music theory at busyworksbeats.com/music theory. Right now you can follow along if you're kind of doing it step by step. So I'm going to add this note F sharp, but you're like, okay, how do I make the note longer? Right now, it's just a short little note. Let's left click and drag it out so we can tell it how long we want it to last. Also, let's go to our mixer and let's turn the piano down. Right now, it's too loud. So all we have here is F sharp. Now, I'm not going to explain music theory in this video. It will take too much time. I'm going to build out the chord here. Let's make this B major. It's either B major or B minor. I think B minor sounds better. So that's our first chord. Now, again, you do not need to understand everything about what I'm doing. You could just follow along in this section. This is minutia. So I'm going to make this a B minor 7 chord. So we're going to use our chord codes, which we go over at busyworksbeats.com/music theory. In this case, this, again, go to the website to learn more. I can't explain it right now. It'll take too long. So I'm using the minor 7 chord code, which is 0, 3, 7, 10. So all we have to do is count up our keyboard starting at the 0 point, which is B. This is 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. This will make the B minor 7 chord. Now let's drop this down an octave. I'm going to hit control down. Not really pleasing in the lower octave. So let's add a bass octave. Okay, so now the next chord is going to be an F sharp chord. Again, you don't have to worry about the terminologies right now. This is way more advanced than what you need to know right now. I'm just trying to give you a good example of how you're going to write songs. So I'm going to write out a 4 bar. Notice the bars are counted at the top. 1, 2, 3, 4. And the reason I went to the playlist and drew out four bars is so that it can actually play. If I only left it two bars, it's not going to play the next notes that I drew in. So you can't preview your chord progression. That's why I like to draw it out longer. If you don't draw it out long enough, you can always left click and drag it out as long as you want. So let's go back to pattern 7 and let's write out that next chord. This will be our F sharp chord. Again, you do not need to worry about the terminology right now. Go to busyworksbeats.com/musictheory to learn more. 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. This will make this an F sharp minor 7 chord. Now my percussion sounds out of tune, so let's go back to tuning the percussion. Instead of changing the MIDI, which I could do, I'm just going to change the pitch. When you're writing, every instrument is not tuned the same. So for example, when I'm playing these notes, B, in the piano, I know it's B because that's tuned properly. The percussion, however, is not necessarily tuned. So if I play the note B, it's not necessarily the note B. So that's why you need to understand tuning. So type in tuning. BusyWorks Beats. But instead of worrying about, you know, the MIDI, let's just change the pitch. And now it matches. Let's say we want to continue the piano. I'm just going to left click and drag it out. The mixer to turn the piano down. Everything does not need to be loud in your mix. So basically we have a bass line. I'm not going to get into adding a bass line and going into a long drawn out thing. I just wanted to show you little common things you're going to see over and over and over again. And that's, you know, the core basics of how you're going to be writing out your song. Okay. So we did everything that you're going to see over and over and over again. The mixer, we dealt with the piano roll, we dealt with the browser, we dealt with the channel rack, we dealt with the playlist, adding in patterns, making things unique. Those are things you're going to be doing all the time, literally. Okay. So now we're going to move into some of the fundamentals again so that we can expand on the functions. If you want to get started for the full strategy guide of FL Studio, go to busyworksbeats.com/FL Studio. I'll be sure to leave the link in the video description below. When you click that link and sign up with your email, be sure to go inside your email and click on the confirm button. Because in Gmail, there's a little confirm button in the subject line, but that doesn't do anything. You need to go inside your Gmail and actually click where it says confirm, sign me up to the list. Once you're signed up, then you'll begin the series. So it's important that you confirm your email address or else we won't send you the series. So thank you for watching today. You can click that link below or go to busyworksbeats.com/FL Studio. Thank you for watching. It's busyworksbeats.com.